June 7th, June 23rd, and July 5th. If anyone has any major revisions that they would like to make, if you could comment on those now, otherwise I'd like to entertain a motion that they be approved as corrected.
So.
And second? It has been moved and seconded that those minutes be approved as corrected. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
And opposed? Motion is carried unanimously. Under correspondence, we have a number of items that have come in. A Department of Environmental Protection findings of fact and order on site location order for Corey Wineshank on Elizabeth Farms. Conservation minutes dated July 7th. A letter to Ernest McVane from legal counsel Thomas Leahy dated July 15th, 1988. A memo to the planning board from Ernest McVane dated July 19th regarding Seneca Heights. A letter from Ernest McVane dated July 11th regarding Seneca Heights. And I believe, if there are any other correspondence coming for us. If not, we'll move on to the first item on our agenda under old business. And the first item is proposed elderly housing ordinance. It's a text change. It will be a public hearing. I would just like to, before we open the public hearing, make a comment that this is our sixth draft. We have been working on this for over a year. The planning board has spent a lot of time and been to visit Falmouth by the Sea, some other sites, to gain the appreciation of what is current in elderly housing and how it's treated. We've also been very fortunate to have some assistance from the First Atlantic Corporation, from the Retirement Management Corporation, the Viking Nursing Home. Representatives from those various groups have aided us in drafting the ordinance, and we want to thank them for their participation. I would like to open the public hearing and ask that anyone who'd like to speak about this please come up and to the podium and give your name, your address, and try to speak very clearly because we are being recorded. The public hearing is now open. Are there any members of the public that would like to ask any questions or make any comments? Maybe I should say that again. They're quiet out there. Are there any members out there who, of the public, who would like to comment about the new ordinance proposed on elderly housing? I think I can say that the planning board is very pleased with the way it has evolved, and if there are no comments, we'll close the public hearing. And I think we could entertain a motion, which hopefully you might find in front of you. Mrs. Duffer.
Madam Chairman, be it ordered that the planning board recommends the attached amendment to the zoning ordinance entitled Housing for the Elderly Ordinance Language, sixth draft, for adoption by the town council.
Is there a second?
Second.
It has been moved and seconded. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
And opposed? It is unanimous, and we have a new ordinance to send on to the town council. They will probably refer to their ordinance committee, and then it in turn will come before our public hearing, and it will be on its way. Thank you. We have another item on the agenda, which is also a public hearing, and that is Spinnaker Heights. This is a minor subdivision review on section 16-2-3, and Dr. Owens is going to make the presentation for us. I will open the public hearing, and Dr. Owens.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'm Tony Owens of Seaview Avenue, representing my partner Gary Cummings of Richmond Terrace and myself for the purpose of presenting Spinnaker Heights before this public hearing. I would like to discuss four areas of importance to the public regarding Spinnaker Heights. They are the location and description of the subdivision, public services and utilities, wetlands and hydrology, and the conservation and public access. Spinnaker Heights is an 8.6-acre parcel at the northern end of Two Lights Road. The subdivision would create three lots, one 4-acre lot and two approximately 2.5-acre lots. In addition, two easements, a one-acre conservation easement to the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust with third-party enforcement rights by the town of Cape Elizabeth, and one pedestrian easement to the town of Cape Elizabeth to facilitate greenbelt access to Two Lights Road and the small pond behind the property. Electricity and water are of sufficient capacity. Three driveways with adequate site distance on Two Lights Road will lead to the building sites. Since town sewer is not provided, adequate on-site septic disposal has been designed. High-intensity soil mapping and test site borings have allowed for three chambered septic systems. These sites have been reviewed and approved by Mr. McVane, Assistant Code Enforcement Officer for the Town of Cape Elizabeth, and Mr. Hardcastle from the State Department of Human Services. Wetlands have been mapped according to the accepted standards of the Army Corps of Engineers. Total wetlands equal 171,600 square feet, or approximately 47% of the total area of the parcel. Impact on wetlands is as follows. On lot one, the driveway would impact on 1,200 square feet. On lot number two would have a total impact of 2,970 square feet, for a total impact for the entire parcel of 4,170 square feet. I should say that approximately 2,000 square feet of that impact is temporary, and that it involves a 2-foot ditch that runs from the house on lot number two to the septic system. It would involve digging the ditch and refilling it, so the impact is temporary. Drainage presently takes place from the west to the east of Two Lights Road beneath the road via three culverts. These will not be disturbed, and the flow of water will not be affected by driveways or building zones. Early in the planning stages, the Conservation Commission and the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust were consulted. There are concerns for the seasonal stream on Lot 1 and the greenbelt access to the small pond behind the property were raised. I believe it is safe to say at this time that the final wording on the easement to the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust for 1 acre of wetland on Lot 1 and the pedestrian easement on Lot 3 has been agreed upon, subject to the approval of the Planning Board and Town Council. I have for distribution to the board a letter hand-delivered today from the Land Trust attorney, basically stating that they have agreed on the final wording, and I have copies of the pedestrian easement and the conservation easement as they presently stand. That concludes my remarks, Madam Chair.
Thank you. Madam Chair, I'm Ted Hollidge. I live on Two Lights Road. I might even almost consider myself one of the few abutters to the project. I'm also on the Conservation Commission and represent the Commission on the Comprehensive Planning Commission. I think that the only concerns that we've raised during the course of the site walks and other things are wetland issues. But I think also it's and I think they've been handled well by Dr. Owens and Gary Cummings. I think it's important to at least mention once again. I think the fact that I've talked several times to Ken Maxwell, who owns the abutting strawberry fields, and the drainage issues are very critical to him in terms of being able to maintain a viable fields in that area. He used to farm lot. He used to farm lot 3, but in fact it's too wet to farm, and so he had to give that up. And I think that he would lose the use of his northerly strawberry fields if anything were done which would interrupt drainage. So I'd like to just urge that drainage considerations be foremost. I think the other fact is that the wetlands percentages and things like that will speak for themselves as you people do your deliberations. Thank you.
Could you just address the drainage, perhaps, Dr. Owens, of the concerning Mr. Maxwell's field and how that relates? Just touch on that.
I'd be happy to. As I mentioned in my presentation, there are three culverts that run beneath Two Lights Road, which drain. If I can step away from the microphone, three culverts which drain the westerly side of Two Lights Road, and they pass beneath the road and have been determined to be of adequate size by our engineer. Additionally, the flow from those culverts will not be diverted or changed in any way, either by driveways or any other obstruction. One of the culverts will flow right into the seasonal stream, which will go in the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust property. Another culvert will flow across the southerly edge of Lot 2 and will be unobstructed because it's in a protected wetland area. And the most southerly culvert, which is right here, will be unobstructed as it drains across and down through the pond and out the backside. There is no obstruction to that. There is no planned grading or fill, driveways, or anything else that would impact on that. We, too, have spoken to Mr. Maxwell about this and taken any of his concerns into our planning of the building zones.
Concerns regarding the wetlands and the siting of the septic systems as proposed on Spinnaker Heights. In the Conservation Commission minutes of July 7th, they note that the majority of soil types in the property would be listed as severely or very severely restricted with respect to residential development. And in the material submitted by you, Dr. Owen, the soil indicators that have come out for the property are somewhat poorly drained to poorly drained soils. In our sidewalk that we took in lot 2, it was extremely hard to tell by vegetation the boundary that existed between the uplands and the wetlands area. And I think that's a point that needs to be addressed given the impact that will be on this wetlands area, and given the overall profile of the area down there and the Two Lights, where the water draining underneath Two Lights Road through this development and down into the Broad Cove area. As for the septic systems in lot 2, that where it is proposed is 120 feet from the culvert and 80 or 50 feet from the drainage area. And from my perspective, this presents another problem area that needs to be addressed. Under subdivision 16-1-1, in section D, we have to address the concerns of unhealthy conditions due to wetlands and the impact that these three systems, and especially the system in lot 2, will have in the larger Broad Cove area. In the soils report that we got back from Mr. Frick from your work, every pit that shows up in the location for the septic system ends with groundwater at from 15 to 24 inches. Another indicator that of a problem down in that area. In the zoning regulations in 19-1-2, we have to consider the most appropriate use of the land, and I'm concerned that this is the most appropriate use of this land, given the undefined nature of the wetlands in Lot 2. We have to, using vegetation and the soils analysis, determine where that land is, and in my opinion, we have not been able to determine where the wetlands and where the uplands begin. I think that what we need to do is take another look at it, especially in Lot 2, and try to determine, get an outside opinion on where that exists. The final point is that in Lot 1, all of the soils are unsuitable. That's what came out of the report, except in an area where it has been filled, evidently a number of years ago from the tree growth that is in that area. That's a common thread throughout this entire development. The problem with the wetlands and the lack of suitability for the soils for the septic systems as are being proposed.
Do you want to respond to that?
Yes, I would. There's a number of questions there. I think that some of them are of a technical nature, and I'd prefer to have Mr. Frick respond to some of the technical issues. As far as the wetlands, Mr. Lordy, who did the wetland mapping for us and who accompanied us on the site walk, was not able to be here tonight, and I don't have anybody else to refer to give you any technical information. I think that we reviewed the Army Corps procedure using the 2 out of 3 criteria, soils, hydrology, and vegetation, and I think Mr. Lordy tried to show us how he came upon devising those lines with the various vegetation and hydrology criteria. I'm certainly not an expert in any of those areas, and we relied on his opinion. I tend to feel he's done a very competent job. The questions about the filled site on Lot 1 and the adequacy and setbacks for the Site 2 area, maybe Mr. Frick could comment on those.
Yes, due to the suitability of the subsurface wastewater disposal systems are deemed to be marginal based on your ordinance, that being the seasonal high groundwater table is less than 24 inches from the soil surface. We requested that Health Engineering, along with Ernie McVeigh, review these sites, and I believe that happened Thursday prior to the site walk. And Mr. Jay Hardcastle from the Division of Health Engineering came down and inspected the three proposed sites and found them to be suitable. The only condition that was lot number one, the setback to the intermittent water course be maintained at 50 feet. That was the condition, and he will be sending the board something in writing shortly if he hasn't already. And that condition will be met when the driveway, it's proposed to be complied with the driveway going into service the location for lot number one. To address the delineation of the wetlands, Mr. John Lordy has submitted a map and he has delineated the wetlands based on the vegetation. I have submitted a soils map showing the soil boundaries, and it's defined in there the upland soils, versus the hydric or potential wetland soils. So I think the board should be able to, with the combination of two, be able to delineate the wetlands. With regards to Mr. Cross' comment, there is an area on lot number two and lot number three that's shown on the soils map that is upland soils, and that is the proposed area for the two disposal systems. Okay. They are required per state requirements and the town of Cape Elizabeth requirements to maintain a 2-foot separation from the bottom of the beds to the seasonal high groundwater table. So those systems are proposed to be modified and elevated above the existing soil surface to give proper treatment.
On lot two, when that was done, and the health engineer was down here from Augusta, is it just the soils criteria that was used, or is it the location, also the location of where that would be in relation to that culvert and the essentially the setbacks from the culvert and from the ditch that comes out of the culvert?
Yes, he was reviewing both soils and site conditions. And the setback requirement, state requirement, is to maintain 100-foot setback to a perennial water course. That's anything that flows greater than 6 months out of the year. And it's mandatory to maintain a 50-foot setback to what is deemed to be an intermittent water course, something that flows for less than 6 months out of the year. The culvert that is closest to lot number two, that was determined by health engineering and myself as well to be an intermittent drainage run. And therefore the disposal system would have to be a minimum of 50 feet set back from that water course per regulations.
Thank you, Mr. Frick. Any other questions, Mr. Cross? Before we open it up to questions from the planning board, I'd like to ask first if there are any further comments from the public. Yes, Mr. Hollidge.
I won't read you. I'm still Ted Hollidge. I wasn't going to get up and respond again, except that I will submit to the planning board some springtime photos, which I've taken, because I would disagree with the gentleman from health engineering. I've been in that site for 12 or 13 years now, and that intermittent water course, I would define it as not an intermittent water course. If 6 months is the only limit we're looking at, it's 9 to 11 months that it runs and that it's full of water. And I don't want to argue with the guy from Augusta, because that would probably get me in trouble, but I will submit these photos, and I'll suggest that I believe having walked up and down that road at least once a week for the Sunday paper and many times other than that, I would suggest that water course runs more than intermittently. And if we're talking 50 foot versus 100 foot setbacks, I got to go with the thought that I think it's got to be 100-foot setback, or we'll have to watch it for 6 months and see how it runs. But I don't want to these gentlemen are my neighbors, and I don't want to get into an argument with them. But I will argue with the gentleman from Augusta. So I will submit these.
Are there any? Did you have any other comments at this point?
I don't think so.
All right. The Conservation Commission.
The Conservation Commission has been concerned with this development from two aspects. One's the wetlands issue, and the other is a conservation easement issue. I can cover both of those. Mr. Frick has just mentioned that there are two definitions of wetlands in the town, and that he has mapped one, and that Mr. Lordy has mapped the other. And I've taken the opportunity to put both of them together. And I'd remind you that the definition of wetlands in Cape Elizabeth Land areas that are periodically submerged or saturated with water as indicated by vegetative characteristics as defined in Circular 39, etc. And all areas designated as having severe or very severe constraints for development because of high water table on the soil survey of the Cumberland County or any revision thereof. This map is a compilation of the composite of the soil characteristics. And it contains the boundaries of
excuse vegetation. Me, could you just move the microphone closer to you so that we can hear you?
Right, this map comprises both the vegetative boundaries shown on Mr. Lordy's map, but also the wetland characteristics as shown by Mr. Frick, and I certainly will bow to his opinion as to my interpretation of severe versus very severe. The green coloration I've put with Swanton, Noskeg, and roundabout soils, and a medium characteristic between severe and very severe on advice from John Malley, who was on our commission, to the Nomberg and Finch soils, and to simply severe to the Augrey and Nickelville soils. And I don't know whether you agree with that or not, but the point is that all of these areas that are colored on this map would, and from what I can find out, be considered wetlands as defined in our wetlands ordinance. I've further taken a planimeter to the driveways that were drawn, and I added 3 feet on each side because I think the wetland, that you'd be unable to build a road unless you disturb soils on each side. No instance did I come to any driveway in any of the single lots in excess of 5,000 square feet, although the combination in the middle lot came to 4,500 square feet, just the driveways that are in the wetland soils themselves. So I just offer that as our interpretation of what the wetlands are on that property, and leave it at that. While I'm up, I might just talk about the pedestrian easement, because probably due to a misunderstanding at our original meeting, a pedestrian easement was offered by the developer to the Conservation Commission early on that in our view at our last meeting we really did not think contained the types of restrictions and rights that really it should, and so we've asked them to come up with another pedestrian easement, which I will say they have. I've had one chance to read it. It's been submitted to the town lawyer, and it appears to be sufficient to our needs, although the commission has not met on that yet.
Thank you. Yes, Mr. Mose.
Dr. Rand, did you also superimpose the wetland as defined by vegetation on that colored map, or is that just soil?
I did, and I'm sorry that it's so difficult to see, Ivan, but it's this orange line, and I assume that means that this is the would be the westerly border of the wetland, and the easterly border is over here. And then there's another area in here. It wasn't clear to me. I simply took, by putting that on the light table, and took the lines off the other map and put them on this one.
Does it generally encompass your most severe soils, or it doesn't follow anything? Does it follow any general? I can't see anything.
It really doesn't. It goes right through this, for example, it goes right through the middle of this very severe wetland over here. And there is another severe area here that does not seem to be in the vegetative area.
Our requirement is not to allow disturbance of 5,000 square feet in the entire development, not just by lot. Isn't that correct?
I'm going to let you determine that.
You said it didn't disturb 5,000.
It's 5,000 square feet per lot.
It is per lot.
As I understand it, but I would think that you probably ought to get other interpretations of that. That is whether or not The ordinance itself accepts from the ordinance itself. That is, the developer does not have to come before the planning board to meet the rest of this ordinance if it says here the provisions of the ordinance shall not apply to the alterations of wetlands which comprise an area less than 5,000 square feet, which are part of an approved public or private way, or for which a building permit has been issued.
This has been a question which we have submitted to our legal counsel and have just recently had some correspondence on this. Mr. Butler, do you want to speak to that?
Yes, the current interpretation is pretty much as Dr. Rand has mentioned. It's on a per lot basis, and that would be 5,000 square feet, unless the subdivision through construction of public improvements, which would occur most often in a major subdivision in terms of roads, water lines, this nature, if those disturb more than 5,000 square feet on the overall site, then wetlands alteration would apply to the whole site. Otherwise, it's on a per lot basis.
Now, we're not considering, I know in the site walk we discussed it, but we're not considering disturbance of wetlands to be the pipes to leach fields a temporary, or is that a disturbance?
That would be a disturbance that would be considered in, under wetlands alteration.
Did you consider that in the number that you came up with per lot?
Only in the middle driveway did I include it, because they went right parallel to the driveway, and so those are in that. The combination, of course, of driveways comes well above 5,000 square feet.
Okay.
Any other questions? Thank you. as perhaps some of you aren't aware, we did go out on a site walk rather recently last week with John Lorty, who was the developer's wildlife specialist. And we had a reconfiguration of the wetlands presented to us that evening, which you all have in your packet now. And there really has not been time for our own town engineer or any of our staff to study the calculations of these wetlands, and I think it might be something that we might want to have looked at before giving any approval or whatever. Are there any other people from the public that would like to speak about Spinnaker Heights? If not, I will close the public hearing and open it up to questions or comments from board and staff.
Madam Chairman, if I could just make one clarification to Mr. Moe's question. The septic system would be served by piping that would go from the leach field to the house site, so it would not follow along the driveway, so there would be some disturbance beyond that, which I think Dr. Rand was initially thinking would occur.
Could I make a comment?
Yes.
I just have a general comment. After taking the site walk and seeing how the wetlands were determined, in my opinion, what we were shown, for me, it was very difficult, as Greg mentioned, very difficult to determine the boundary. I had a hard time after looking at, actually walking in on Lot 2 and walking around Lot 2, I had a hard time. I saw a big band, a huge band of land that could fall either way. I just couldn't draw the judgment. Of course, I'm not trained in that area either, so what I'm applying is an untrained eye to it, but I don't feel comfortable with what I saw. I have to be honest with you on that, in terms of the boundaries that were displayed for wetlands. And what I see in the soils area tonight even further reinforces that.
I too have some problems about feeling very secure about where the wetlands are. I thought Mr. Lorty did an excellent job in describing the method that he had used. I think it's very important, however, for the town to take a look at this and do their own calculations, and I think that perhaps this should be done before the next month's meeting. I would welcome any other comments, or I also feel that apparently the easements and the land trusts seem to be in good order, but I think two of those things should be reviewed by our town staff before we make any decisions. Any other comments? Mrs. Guthrie.
Madam Chairman, of great concern to me would be the drainage and the strawberry fields. And to date, we have from our engineer only a letter dated June 13th having to do with the subsurface disposal systems. And I'm assuming that we will be receiving correspondence regarding the drainage and Mr. Maxwell's strawberry fields.
That should also be added to a list of things that should be taken care of before we meet again, I think. Are there any other questions or comments? Mr. Mitchell.
Can I respond?
Yes.
John Mitchell from Mitchell & One Associates. I believe a drainage report, which was prepared by BH2M Civil Engineers, was submitted months ago when we were dealing with the previous applicant. And that very briefly addressed the drainage flows from across the street, Strawberry Fields.
But, sir, we have a report here dated July 7th from the Conservation Commission stating that they are very concerned about that drainage. And that's, I mean, your report might have been submitted months ago, but these are the minutes of the meeting of April 7th, I think, of the Conservation Commission. And they are obviously, from Mr. Hollidge's testimony, still very concerned about that. So we would need to get our engineer's opinion on something like that anyway.
I believe Bob Hunter responded to our initial drainage report and really didn't have any concerns regarding that. If there are any specific drainage questions, I'd appreciate hearing them now so that I can relay them to our engineers so that we can address them.
I think that perhaps it would be best to have our town planner draw up a number of items that we feel would be helpful for us to receive before the next month's meeting and pass them along to you.
Madam Chairman,
yes.
If I may, it's, Mr. Mitchell is correct in that on December 9th, with some different set of applicants, the town engineer did review the drainage plan and found that there wouldn't be any major impacts. And the only suggestion he made was to change the driveway culverts from 12-inch in diameter to 15-inch. But if I'm hearing the board asking for a second review, then I think that could be done.
I think in light of some of the material that we've seen tonight and also heard, that we do need to have just a little bit more information before we make a decision.
Well, one other point of clarification, if I may. Dr. Rand indicated that he had done a calculation on the wetland disturbance, and his calculations indicated that it came out more than 5,000 square feet of disturbed wetland per lot. I'm sorry. Okay. Okay. As has been mentioned tonight, John Lordy has redefined the wetland limit. On lot two, it was significantly changed. And I have very accurately, which is indicated on your most recent site plan, indicated the exact disturbance of the wetlands for each of the lots. And it's indicated up in the notes. I think it's the last note. It was done with a scale very accurately, not a preliminary. So I feel very comfortable in those figures.
And that totals to 4,100 square feet.
That's correct. And that includes the installation of the sewer line on lot two, which was, I believe it was 138 feet in length by 15 feet in width.
Thank you. That's helpful. Any other comments or questions? Yes, Mr. Butler.
One more question for the applicant. On the site walk, there was, we looked at the building zone for Lot 1 and saw that part of it extended slightly into the revised wetlands boundary. You know, suggested that that building zone line perhaps could and would be moved slightly. Just want to see what your intentions are with that.
Yes, that will be revised. We just don't have an updated plan redrawn.
I would just comment that the next date for submission is July 29th, so the material should be in by then in order to get on the August agenda. Mr. Russ, did you have
a quick question about the location of the intermittent stream? It may be indicated on the plans, but I'm not sure I can identify it. Could you either identify it for me or indicate on your new plans where that
We can certainly do that on the new plan. The for now, there's basically two streams. The larger one, which is more northerly, and then I think the intermittent stream that Mr. Hollidge was concerned about is sort of towards the south along the boundary line between the Roman Catholic Church and lot number two. I can point it out to you if you'd like.
Any other comments, questions? If not, we thank you very much for your presentation, and we'll look forward to seeing you in August. And again, the reminder that submission dates are July 29th.
Point of information on this. Did we close the hearing at this point?
We did close the public hearing, and then we have 30 days to make a decision. Just for the information of the general public, we have 30 days to make a decision as to whether we would deny, approve, or approve with conditions, or grant an extension of time if needed.
Thank you.
Our next item of business is Catherine Violet, a condition of site plan approval, submitting the buffer plan. And Catherine Violet is here to amplify her plans for the buffer. You are on.
Okay. You got the plan that I submitted, right?
Yes.
A copy of it. I called Skillings and explained the whole situation of the yard to him, and he told me that the Hatfield U would be good in this area. It's very bushy and grows to be about 10 feet tall and needs very little sun and is a good noise buffer. And then on the left, I put a sea green juniper, which needs a lot of sun. And he said that is also a good noise buffer. Other than that, on the right-hand side, going towards 8 Elmwood Road, the lilacs cover the greatest part of the yard. And there
is... Excuse me, how much is uncovered there? Roughly.
Let me go by the sections of the fence. 20, possibly three sections of fence, 24 feet at tops.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I didn't mean to interrupt you.
No, that's okay. On that side, I don't have a problem with that neighbor anyway, as far as complaints or noise. I don't know if this matters, you know. I know we're having the problem with a woman in back of me. That's basically it.
I think we have to make our considerations for a longer period of time than just current neighbors. It's got to be a buffer
neighbors change and neighborhoods change, and I do think, I agree with Mr. Most, we have to think of posterity rather than the short-term cure.
But I am short-term for now. Anyway, I am, you've given me a year. I have to come back in a year.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so I'm looking at the money. If it doesn't go over in a year, I've already spent a lot of money, which, I mean, I know if you tell me, I have to keep spending it. But
I think what we're interested in seeing happen is to assure that the business that you're operating mm-hmm. doesn't have an undesirable impact mm-hmm. on the neighborhood, even yeah. in a year's time.
Yeah.
And I know Mr. Butler checked with some nurseries about mm-hmm. vegetation, and I think that he has some suggestions, and I'll let him comment on that, Mr. Butler.
Thank you. I think most of you read the memo that I prepared on this matter. I called, I checked with a couple landscape architects and called O'Donnell's and Skillin's just to kind of get a better handle or a good handle on what might be desirable. It turns out that when I called around, there were two plants that were recommended that would appear to be slightly preferable to the Hatfield yews that Ms. Violette's suggesting. Those would either be arborvitae, which is really a cedar tree, or white pine tree. And the reason for that is that for noise buffering, they have about the same impact, but they grow much faster than the Hatfield yews. Calling back after talking with Ms. Violette, in terms of the amount of sun that was required, I did check back and asked them again to reconsider and explore it a little bit further. Turns out that the white pine trees don't grow well in a shaded situation, but that the arborvitae do with getting little to partial sun. So in terms of that, the Hatfield yews are comparable, or the arborvitae are comparable to Hatfield yews and still would grow a little bit faster. It's up to the board, but in terms of making sure that the trees get up to an adequate size and provide the maximum amount of noise buffering, it appears as though the arborvitae might be slightly preferable. Also, in terms of the numbers of trees, as my memo indicates, that if you were to go with arborvitae, that I would suggest that they'd be planted 6 feet apart so that within 3 to 5 years, a complete noise buffer and screen would be provided. On the plans, there's only three Hatfield yews shown in the back, so I think that might need to be increased slightly.
Did you happen, this really isn't under our purview, but did you check on the price of the, did you do some comparative shopping?
I didn't compare between the Hatfield yews and the arborvitaes, although
I did.
Okay.
That doesn't sound good.
No, I did. No, actually the seed of the arborvitae is cheaper than the Hatfield yew, much cheaper, so, you know, I don't have a problem with that.
Also, I don't know, but most yews have little berries that are rather poisonous, so that might be hazardous to the children in the yard if children like to pop things in their mouths. And I think that's another consideration as far as the yew is concerned.
At this point, you know, it's obviously, I'm just going to go along with anything you want. I just want to get it done, get it over with.
Well, I think it's up to this planning board to approve or disapprove, make suggestions as mm-hmm. to. I think personally, I would feel that 24 feet that is not covered by a buffer should be buffered with some further plantings, just because if you do continue beyond a year, and even if your neighbor should move, mm-hmm. it would be good to have that area protected and buffered. I'd like to get other planning board members' views.
Madam Chairman,
yes.
I agree with that. I think that's an excellent point. And I would support the suggestion that we do that.
I'd also suggest that we require additional plannings, as the planner has suggested. This is a one-year, assuming that we approve it, a one-year permit, and the problem, if one exists, is going to start immediately. And I think the closer the plannings, the more immediate that buffer effect is going to be for the neighbor who has a concern. I have a question for you, Ms. Violet.
Mm-hmm.
You've indicated in your plan substantial plannings on the property behind yours.
Right.
It's not the responsibility of that neighbor to provide buffering against another adjacent use, but that might be something we take into consideration. I haven't really seen the property, so I don't know how dense it is, but there may be some buffering effect already in place, which might have a mitigating effect on just how close the new plantings have to be. I don't know whether you want something.
I think that there was another comment or question. Mrs. Kevin.
I just wanted to ask Mrs. Violet, is it true that these Hatfield views or these arborvitae take approximately 5 years to reach maturity?
I don't have the answer to that.
Yes, what's being suggested would be that Ms. Violet planned trees would be between 4 and 6 feet in height, and once they're planted, and that it takes about 3 to 5 years to perform a complete, what they call almost a living wall that would provide the maximum amount of noise buffering. So it would take 5 years to get the maximum benefit. There is some buffering capacity with the trees once they're planted, if they're planted densely enough now. And the reason why they're suggested to be planted 6 feet apart is that when they do grow in, that there's enough room so that they don't eventually choke each other out. The final height for the arborvitae, at least, is somewhere between 10 and 14 feet at full maturity. And with trimming, they can be as short as the trimming.
Well, I too have been to the site, and I certainly don't have anything against daycare or Mrs. Violet, but unfortunately, many of the homes in that area are elevated from this particular property, as far as I could see. There are hills behind this property, and it seems to me that all of the buffering in the world is not going to change the noise that is going to emanate from a yard where 8 to 10 children are playing. I think we just have to be very realistic and admit that it is, that the noise is going to emanate despite the yews or the arborvitae, and it will take 5 years for these trees to reach maturity. So that's the comment I have.
Thank you, Mrs. Guthrie. Any other comments or questions? Mr. Butler?
Just to clarify for the board where we are, Ms. Violet has gotten approval from the Zoning Board of Appeals. At the last meeting, the Planning Board gave a conditional approval, and the one condition being that she prepare a buffering plan that would come back for your review and approval. In terms of where we stand now, I guess we need to hear exactly what you feel is required. Question then becomes, do we somehow incorporate that into a motion upon a motion, or do we ask Ms. Violet to go back, kind of prepare a new plan and submit it to the town or back to the board? That's something that another decision for you to make.
What's the inclination of the board at this point? I think we have some very specific ideas as to what we want to see for plantings, and
I'd rather not, Madam Chairman, see this come back to the board. What I'd rather do is arrive at what we think is appropriate, and if there are some minor changes, give our planner the authority to approve a final plan.
Would you like to make a motion starting out with "be it ordered" to that effect?
Well, I was working on that, but
I'm a little concerned about the poisonous berries.
Well, no, that's not on the arborvitae. Oh, it's not. On the yews. So,
okay.
So you're all right with arborvitae. Right. You're just fine. No toxic.
All right, good. Well, then, I would like to suggest or move that the approval for use as a daycare be conditioned on the planting of arborvitae at intervals of 6 feet apart along the rear property line, and that a buffer of a similar nature, and not knowing how much sun is on the right side of your property from the lilacs to the end of the to the property line, a similar
arborvitae
buffering at that open location.
To fill in the gap between the open space and
yes.
the existing
That's
lilacs.
Right. Yeah.
And incorporate the idea of a juniper that she has included on her plan.
Oh yes.
Point of information. I'd like to second it, but before I do, well, maybe I should second
we
it.
We can second it and then have discussion.
Yeah, I'll second it.
All right.
And we open for discussion. Wait,
is there any discussion?
Is it necessary to incorporate all the other conditions that the zoning board had, or have we already passed a motion incorporating those?
The zoning board has already given them permission for its use. So really what we're concerned with is the site plan review, which doesn't, so we don't have
so
to get into times or that sort of thing.
We don't have to incorporate.
No, in effect, you've already given approval and you're really just dealing with a modification of one of the conditions that you placed on your approval.
My second stands as it is on
Any other discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
Nay.
The motion is 4-1 with Mrs. Guthrie in the negative. Yes?
Clarification after the fact, sorry. Does that mean then that Ms. Violet will then prepare a new plan, and then the town staff, meaning myself, will then look at it and make sure it meets the requirements that you put forward in the motion?
I would hope that that would take place.
So what I
so you
I
have
to do is every 6 feet put one of these
arborvitaes
and my juniper, and I'm home free.
There you are. You have your permit, as long as you submit it to the planner, town planner, and staff, so that they can review the to make sure
if
that
you
it is.
Just drop another plan before you do the plantings. That would be
okay. Now did well. Okay.
All right.
Thank you. Yep.
Thank you very much. Our next item of business is of old business, and it's getting older and older, is Elizabeth Farms coming in for an amended subdivision plan signing under section 16-2-5. And Mr. Weinchen, you are here.
Good evening.
Good evening.
As you very correctly stated, I'm here hopefully to have our amended site plan signed. I believe Mr. Butler has the original for that. And there's a list, according to a letter from me, July 21, thank you, 1988, of the submittals that were accompanying this final plan, signing amended, whatever it is, which I believe is a complete list of everything we need. We did, just by the way, finally get on the 13th of July our DEP order relative to this matter. And I'm not sure, to tell you the truth, whether
yes, that came in. That is okay. On our table tonight, so that
great.
Is complete.
Are there any questions that I can answer, I hope?
I'll just remind the board that if you recall at the last month's meeting, we did set the bond for $63,000, which was recommended by Mr. Hunter. So we have taken that step, and I believe that we're up to snuff now with all materials in which were requested. And those include checking in with the Central Maine Power and as well as the DEP.
Yep.
And we don't really have to have a motion, so unless there are any... Oh, excuse me, we do. I'm sorry, misspoke. So we do have to have a motion, and you have one in front of you if... Someone would like to make that.
Madam Chairman, before we have a motion, just a quick question. Under Attachment C, dated June 27, is a letter from T.Y. Lins regarding the review of construction plans, et cetera, and a letter from Pinkham Greer. And it had to do with an easement from Mr. Doughty, and T.Y. Lins, I always call it, said that the easement is not required. Now, this isn't an engineering firm. Do we have a legal opinion on this? Is it needed?
Mr. Butler?
We don't have a legal opinion. What the question that town engineer was answering regarded was there a need for the drainage, what the drainage mm-hmm. easement that was shown on the previous plan was just that, it was for drainage, and so what Bob Hunter reviewed was whether or not to fulfill the needs of the drainage ditch on that side of the road, was there a need to have an easement that would extend beyond the Elizabeth Farms property onto that owned by the abutting property owner. And from an engineering perspective, Bob Hunter said no, that everything could be accommodated on site, and therefore he felt that the easement was required.
Okay, so there wouldn't be any legal problems with this whatsoever. Thank you.
Any other questions before we entertain a motion?
Just one question. We were going to put the new plan and the old plan on the light table and compare the changes. Was that done?
That was done, and the changes that were described at the last meeting were the only ones that were on the plans. There were some other cleaning up items. They're both looked at, and I also put on the light table, and Mr. Weinschenk provided the Mylars before, the plan, the paper copy of the plan that was submitted to the board, as well as the Mylar, which you'll be signing tonight, and they also corresponded. So the three changes that we were talking about, the change in the reference to the Registry of Deeds book page number, the removal of the easement line, and then the slight change in the line lots. Five and six were the only changes.
Thank you.
Are we ready for a motion? Mrs. Guthrie?
Be it ordered that the request of Rick Weinschenk and Company for an amendment to their approved subdivision plan for Elizabeth Farms Coal Field, located off Sawyer Road, be granted in accordance with Section 16-2-5 of the Subdivision Ordinance and the facts presented.
And a second?
Second.
It has been moved and seconded. Is there any discussion? If not, all those in favor, please raise your right hand. It is unanimous. And if you will bring up a pen in the proper color, we will complete. I believe you're right there.
She does. I really get confidence of it, but then I can't live it.
head. That was excellent, too.
Greg, get a chance to get your signature on it.
It's more interesting to me than being able to. We'll now go on to another rather short item of business. Gaucrest Farms had a workshop with the planning board earlier this evening, and they have requested an extension, or to be tabled, actually. So I would like to ask a planning board member if they would be good enough to make that motion. And a tabling motion cannot be debated, nor can it be amended, so this could be very short and sweet.
Ready?
Ready.
Be it ordered that the request, I move, be it ordered that the request by the Gaucrest Development Corporation for a 1-month tabling of consideration of Goldcrest Farm, a proposed 38-lot subdivision located off Berwick Avenue, be granted according to section 16-2-4 of the subdivision ordinance as facts presented.
Is there a second?
Second.
It has been moved and seconded. All those in favor, please raise your right hand. It is unanimous, and we will go on to our next item, which comes under new business, Mr. John Griffin. Mr. Griffin is coming in for a site plan review. He has a dry cleaning business, which he is proposing under section 19-2-9. And we're even a little early. I hope that's all right with you.
I'll just get to bed a little early tonight. I am proposing locating a laundry dry at 297 Ocean House Road. This here, it is a commercial zone. It is located approximately across from Irving Oil. It has a residence, and beside the residence, it has a garage. My proposal, I have been before the Board of Appeals, at which time I asked for a variance on the setbacks. The garage was going to stay in the same footprint, but I was going up a second story. There was approximately 688 square feet on the ground floor, and we're adding approximately 520 feet on the second floor. The other thing that I was asking the Board of Appeals for was a variance on the parking, based on the fact that the second story would only be used for storage, and that the and on May 24th, they moved to grant the variances of 15-foot, two setbacks in the front, and 1'9" from the, on the side, and 2'9" on the rear to construct a second-story addition on top of the existing garage, in accordance with the plans prepared by Gowan Associates, dated 4/28. They did put some provisions on there, provided only that the second story be used only for storage, and that the family and employees' parking will be in the rear of the property, and that the six parking spaces be deemed as satisfactory to section 19.3.5, provided that the proposed laundromat dry cleaning facility will not ever be self-service. And this was never the plan that it be self-service. Also at that time, I spoke to them in regard to my desire to keep the rear right-of-way as a private way, and not infringe upon the residential nature of that back section at all, which is the section, this is the right-of-way that runs out to Scott Dyer, no. This is Ocean House Road here, and Scott Dyer Road comes in over here. And the right-of-way runs down in between Mr. Hennessy's property and Mr. Hennessy appeared before the board. One of the concerns was that the rear entrance not be used for commercial purposes, and I highly agree with that. I am proposing putting a fence along there to make sure that from the side of the garage over to the lot line, and I would imagine that a barrier will be erected on Mr. Hennessy's property across from there according to his plans. Everything doesn't slide down on the floor here. The design of the garage, this is the what it looks like from the end as it appears now. This is the proposal. What I had proposed to the Board of Appeals was taking the roof line, which went this way, and turning it so that it would not overpower the residents next to it, and it would appear more as a separate entity, adding the doors and two windows. This plan is shown, shows Ocean House Road over here. It shows the entrance coming in from Ocean House Road into the front. This being the garage, or the dry cleaning, the entrance being to it here. This area over here, the topography of it is such that it is mostly ledge and vegetated with brush and lilacs. Originally, on the proposal, I had the parking spaces at a diagonal angle, and after conferring with Mr. Butler, your planner, and also I noticed that when the letter came back from T.Y. Lynn, it suggested that I might be wrong, which right away I figured that out. I have since, and I gave to Mr. Butler a revised plan, changing these parking spaces so they're perpendicular, also adding additional 4 feet here so that the turning radius would be acceptable, taking out the stockade fence, which T.Y. Lynn felt would hinder the removal of snow, or the snow couldn't be banked up there properly. Also, at the time, we also added some riprap here because this is ledge, in order to retain soil that was on it and be able to hold that soil and have no problem of erosion. We are proposing putting that in. We also added the fence here from the side of the building over to the line so that we could further keep this of a residential nature in the rear. We have proposed a landscaping plan, which is laid out on the plan, buffering in here, also landscaping out here, and in the front of the building.
Excuse me, what kind of landscaping are you putting out going towards the road? What are you using there? My concern is just really with the height of the...
Oh, no. It'll be low-lying type vegetation. It will not block the line of sight or the view. There is a portion of ledge that Mr. Hennessy will be removing off towards the right, the property line that lies under the mine dot right away. What type of vegetation we will be using and the size of the plantings is listed on the plan on the left. Let me get over the other side here so I can see. Some of the things that I have with me tonight Bill Bray, who is the traffic engineer from Portland, who did the Hennessy study on the traffic impact and also did mine. The reason that I couldn't get mine in earlier was that he felt that he wanted to take and do a new traffic study and account because it had been some time since he'd done one for Mr. Hennessy, and it was a different location. That he did, and he did submit for this meeting the traffic study. And I will let Mr. Bray address that. Bill.
As Mr. Griffin indicated, we did update the earlier traffic study that was completed for Mr. Hennessy's project. First, a new traffic count was taken during the month of June, in fact, the first week of June. That data was compared with the count that was taken in February, and there was a considerable difference between the February count and the June count. This report was based on the higher of the two volumes, which was the June count. It was factored in accordance with Maine Department of Transportation standard factors, and the entire study was based on that factoring of the data. I'd like to just point out to the board, and I'm sure that there'll be a question to me if I don't comment on it, so I'll see if I can head you off. The reason that I've indicated in this report the pavement markings again at the intersection was because this report was actually written and typed prior to the meeting that you held for Mr. Hennessy's project, and I do apologize. It's not intended to continually bring up the item. It was just that it happened to be an overlap in the two projects that I was working on. So the accident information that was presented in Mr. Hennessy's report is the same as presented in this report. Probably the most critical element, at least in my opinion, on this project was the site distance, not looking to the right from this driveway, but looking to the left from the driveway towards the intersection. Based on the town standards of location of measuring points, I am able to achieve a measurement of 385 to 400 feet of site measurement, and I believe included in your report, a copy of the report, it shows where those measurement points were taken, which are in accordance with the town standards. To achieve anything greater than that 385 to 400 feet, it would require the removal of the 28-inch maple tree that does sit within the, I'm not sure if it's the town or the actual main DOT right-of-way, but it's not on private property. It's actually within the public right-of-way. But to achieve anything greater than the 385 to 400 feet, it would require the removal of that tree. But I will point out that the 385 feet does comply with the town standard of 110% over the posted speed limit of 35 miles per hour. To get an approximation of the number of vehicle trips that the project would generate, in discussing this with Mr. Griffin, he undertook a survey of a current business that is located in the Oak Hill Shopping Center over off of Route 114. And in the report, you will see a half-hour survey that was taken for 5 days that indicates a trip rate for a similar type laundromat. This data was factored down to the approximate square footage that this operation will be, and it appears that you could expect somewhere around 6 trips in the AM peak hour and 4 trips in the PM peak hour that would enter the site during the rush hour of traffic during those two periods of the day. As is the case with most service type industries, the majority of the traffic that's attracted to those businesses during the rush hour, that traffic is already in the existing traffic stream. I've assumed that 75% of the traffic that will enter and exit this during the two peak hours is already on the street. And as I had indicated in the report, a good argument could be made that all of that traffic is actually on the street. Although I tried to take a more conservative approach and assume that 25% of the traffic entering and exiting the site during the peak hours would actually be new vehicle trips to the street. That traffic was assigned to the existing street network, and then a capacity analysis of the Ocean House Scott Dyer Road intersection was undertaken to see if the project would have any effect on the operation of that intersection. The results of that analysis indicate that there would be no change in the level of service at the intersection based on the addition of the site trips estimated in this report. I took one further step in analyzing traffic at the intersection of Scott Dyer Road and Ocean House. Anytime the side street volumes exceed 100 vehicles per hour during the busy hours of the day, traffic engineers should at least be alerted to the fact that traffic signals, or cycled traffic signals, if you will, may be warranted at that location. I examined the existing traffic volumes in accordance with the Manual on Uniform Traffic Control Devices to make that determination if traffic signals were currently warranted at the intersection with the new traffic volumes that were collected in June. And on page 5 of my report, you will note the outcome of that analysis. Traffic signals are not presently warranted at the intersection, and with the DOT having jurisdiction over the Route 77 highway, they could only be installed once the warrants in the manual were met in some fashion. And as I have indicated, the three warrants that are applicable to this location were not satisfied with the existing conditions. With that, I'd try to answer any question that I could from the traffic standpoint that the board may have.
May I ask you perhaps a non-technical question? What is your feeling about, from a safety point of view, about removing that 28-inch maple, considering the intersection and the...
I spent a great deal of time at the intersection, and I chose the step of not measuring vehicle speed, and I chose the 110% of the posted speed. And it would be my opinion, looking at that area, that actually vehicles approaching in that area are traveling a little bit less than the 35 miles an hour. At least that would be my observation. And if you look behind, and it's difficult to try to explain it, but if you can look slightly behind that 28-inch maple tree, there actually is another window of visibility beyond looking towards the intersection. And because of the condition of the tree, I would certainly make a recommendation to the board that the site distance is met, and it is met in accordance with the town standards and actually in accordance with ASHTO standards. I would recommend that you leave the tree as it is. It's a good-looking tree, and it would be a shame, in my opinion, to remove the tree.
Oh, thank you, Mr. Burry. Any other questions?
I'd just like to understand, you said the operation of, based on square footage and the operation of the cleaner in Oak Hill, that you're looking at 6 trips during the peak morning hour, is that right?
That's correct. It would be six trips coming in during the site, and I've assumed that every trip that comes into the site would exit during that same period. You'd have 6 entering trips and 6 exiting trips during that 1 hour period in the morning.
That just seems very low for a business like that.
Yeah. Well, again, this is based on the data that Mr. Griffin took as a survey in his business over off of Route 114.
And that's survivable economically? Perhaps you could come up and address that point at the...
I naturally expect the business to grow, but there are some things that comes into the business at Oak Hill that doesn't go through the front door as far as the customer. It's pickup and delivery, and it's commercial accounts. Mm-hmm. So
I certainly would
be running a business that isn't making money.
What would you, I hope not, I imagine you've done a market survey perhaps even. What is your projection then as far as how many more trips would you anticipate?
I would...
During peak hours.
Whoops, excuse me. That's a very hard. I am going to start doing, once I'm established, doing pickup and delivery in Cape Elizabeth. So that'll increase with one truck? That's correct. So it increased my business, but it wouldn't increase the trips in and out. I think that you can expect at least a 10 to 15% increase in business per year for the first 5 years. But as I say, this I've done some market surveys, but that's all guesstimates.
Thank you. Yes, Mrs. Guthrie.
Madam Chairman, while Mr. Griffin is at the microphone, I have just a couple of questions, Mr. Griffin. There seems to be a discrepancy in our packets. According to Owen Haskell Incorporated, on June 6th, he wrote that the single-family house, which is currently on the property, will remain, and he has it in quotes, as is. That means that that will remain a residential home. Is that correct? Someone is going to live there.
As a matter of fact, it's my son-in-law, my daughter, and my grandson.
Well, I saw that home, Mr. Griffin. My compliments. It's a very charming home. When I went on a site walk to view Mr. Hennessy's property, I couldn't help but notice it, and I'm glad that you're saving it. However, that doesn't seem to be the opinion of TYLIN. On July 11th, and I think that records should show that we received from our town engineer a letter stating, we have reviewed the site plan and supporting documents for the conversion of a single family residence on Route 77 to a dry cleaning establishment. That isn't very clear, and I think that it should be made clear. And another thing that troubles me is, according to Section 19-3-2 of the zoning ordinance, that's on page 19-22C, about main buildings on all lots, no additional main building shall be constructed on any lot unless the lot size and location of each building is such that a separate lot could be created for each building, and each such lot would conform to the provisions of this ordinance under Section 19-3-1. Now, Mr. Griffin, you have just stated that this is a commercial property, and I agree with you, but the house was the main building on that lot. The garage was your secondary building. Now, I need help with the interpretation of ordinances because I don't understand what we're doing here. You still have the main building, the house, and you're creating another main building, the dry cleaning establishment. I really need help from people who know. I mean, what happens when this is conveyed, if Mr. Griffin ever conveys this?
Mr. Griffin, do you want to comment?
Well, just a comment. Number one, the residential nature of the residence exists as grandfathered and can remain a residence until it is unoccupied for that purpose for more than a year. Then it is no longer grandfathered, and if you wanted to maintain it as residence, you'd have to come back before a board to get permission for the use.
But if you have a single lot, do you not? These are not two lots.
That's correct. It's one lot.
So you see where I'm having the problem in interpretation. I don't know what the answer is. I'm just raising.
What will happen if the property is ever conveyed? There will be a lease of that specific area of the property back to me. Which I checked with, it is a legal conveyance, can be done that way. And I would have a lease on the property for a period of time.
But according to our ordinances, I'm just wondering if we can do this.
Mr. Butler, do you want to comment?
Sure.
I believe we can, and something that we can double check with the code enforcement officer, or you can check with
Mr. Daigle.
The main building requirement in the zoning ordinance, however, applies to two separate detached buildings that would be, if there's one main building on a property, let's say if there was a residence, and another residence were desired to be built, or a dry cleaning operation, a separate and distinct structure, then at that point, that is where the main building standard would come in, as I understand it. Mm-hmm. And so this is really an expansion of an existing structure upward, and it's a conversion from solely residential to now a mixed residential.
Yeah, that I understand, but which is the main building? The house or the dry cleaner?
Well, I think that Mr. Hunter fully understands, because he looked at the existing plans, and if he did, there was no way that he could misconstrue that it included the residence and the garage.
No, but I have a question in my mind. If this property were conveyed, what are you conveying? I mean, you have a single lot. What if the next owner wants to make two businesses on a lot that only can support one? What control would the town have over that?
You would have
to come before the board. Any changes would have to come back before the board.
I know that, but it's just the whole
excuse
process.
Excuse me, Mr. Daigle might shed some light on it.
I think I know the answer. You have to remember that particular rule that you're reading from does not apply in this case, because this particular lot is located in business zone. And in business zone, we don't have a set lot size. And I believe it's a VA zone.
Yes, it is.
Well, this says main buildings on all lots.
Yes.
It doesn't differentiate.
You're absolutely correct, except when it comes to the case of business zone. In the business zone, the lot size requirement is not exactly the same as in RA and in RC.
And to follow up on that, there's only one main building. There are two, perhaps, main uses, but I think that provision primarily deals with the structure.
Mm-hmm.
And so, as it's proposed now, you're dealing with one structure.
Yes, well, that would mean then that in an RA zone, and you might have one lot, could you conceivably attach another house to the house that you live in, and you're just creating one building, you could say then?
The answer there would be no, because there you already have one house on a lot, and it would be sized properly, under 80,000. In order for you to have that, can't happen in all the central in business zone. Here we have one main dwelling, and it's going to remain really one main dwelling in certain uses.
Well, I'm still not convinced. And do you think it would be possible to get some legal advice on this? I have nothing against this business. It's a nice, clean business. But I just want to make sure that we're doing everything properly.
If it would make the board feel more comfortable, I'm sure that we can get an interpretation of that before we meet again. Are there any other questions or comments, Mr. Griffin?
I would like to finish up on the
yes.
on the presentation. There is the area of that was addressed by Mr. Owen Haskell in his report. You all have it, I believe. Existing water and sewer service to the house will be utilized with additional underground electric telephone service installed from Route 77. Access to the business will be from Route 77 with a new 20-foot wide paved driveway. Parking for 6 vehicles is provided in accordance with the variance from the Board of Appeals. We've computed the stormwater runoff from the site for both a 2-year and a 25-year storm. Most of the site sheds surface water southeasterly towards Route 77. In addition, runoff from an abutting area to the north crosses a lot flowing southeasterly toward Route 77. Most of this area is quite flat with slopes of 1% or less. There is no underground storm drain in this section of Route 77. The collected surface runoff is being conveyed in the gutters on the edge of the road. Peak runoff rates for the drainage area along in drawing one are as follows. 2-year storm, 0.53 peak before development, cubic feet per second, and 0.56 after development. 25-year storm, 2.01 before development, and 2.07. The net increase after development would be 6% for a 2-year storm and 3% for a 25-year storm. And because the area of the proposed construction is about 6,500 square feet, including new driveway, building addition, and vegetative alteration, we have not included a detention basin in the site plan per section 19.29, which alludes to over 10,000 square feet. The site will be landscaped to screen the parking area to protect the existing knoll at the southeast corner of the lot. Existing shrubbery, grass, and trees will be left undisturbed as much as possible. In addition, a stockade fence, which I have since removed, which was going to be along the line, we felt that it wouldn't be necessary, and TYLN suggested it be removed because of snow removal. So I very wisely removed it. And I have additional copies of the plans with showing those corrections with me. Steve Butler has one that showed the correction. I went over it with him. And incidentally, he's the one that suggested it before TYLN did. There's an accompanying soils are as identified by the Cumberland County Soil Survey, are mostly Hollis, the Sum Deerfield, and Hinckley. And these are moderately to excessively well-drained with ledge outcrops in the Hollis soils. The accompanying sedimentation and erosion control plan is based upon the Environmental Quality Handbook Maine, prepared by the Maine Soil and Water Conservation Commission. There will be temporary erosion control during construction. We're going to schedule work to minimize exposure of bare ground, accomplish prompt completion of all earthwork. We're going to apply hay melts to stockpiles of loam and excavated soils embankments steeper than 4%. They had to be left exposed for more than 10 days. Mulch will be applied at the rate of 80 pounds per 1,000 square feet. And we're also going to, at the corner of the lot over here, we're going to provide siltation fence near the southeast corner of the lot during construction. And on the permanent erosion control, we're going to establish permanent grass cover on all areas disturbed by construction, except the paved areas, mulched areas around plants. Apply loam, fertilizer, lime, seed, and hay mulch as shown on the plans. And after germination, reseed any bare spots to obtain complete coverage. On-site topsoil shall be used to maximum extent possible. And we're going to install 2-inch bark mulch around all the plants, at least 3-inch diameter to the outside crown, whichever is greater. The lighting is being provided by two lights, one here and one here. That lighting will be exterior lights, 250-watt high-pressure sodium cutoff luminate with painted aluminum housing, and it's going to be as manufactured by Hi-Tech Pole. The lot area is 13,464 square feet. As I said, it was zone business A, and the distance to the nearest residential zone is 137 feet. And it will be soil fertilized and planted by the indications of the landscaping plan as per this plan here. And I guess that concludes my presentation. I'd be happy to answer any questions the board may have.
Thank you, Mr. Griffin. I have a question on your submissions. Do you have evidence of right, title, and interest in the property that you're submitting? as a part. You do have that.
Yes.
If you could forward that to the board, that would be helpful. And also, do you intend to have any signs indicating your business
location? I do. I indicated the position of the sign is over here. I want to wait and see what the sight distance is and everything so it doesn't block anything. The sign will be of a type of sandblast engraved with a light on it, trying to keep it...
It will be wooden sign?
Wooden sign.
Yes.
Yes. Not lighted from the interior, but lighted from exterior lighting.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yes. Are there any other questions? Yes, Mr. Mose.
Will there be any hazardous waste stored over?
I have submitted to a letter to... I can just find it here. To the Fire Chief, Donald Webster, dated June 13th. And he responded to the board on June 17th. And it more or less states that after reviewing the plans of this project and discussing it with Mr. Griffin, my concerns would be the operation be limited to type 4 non-flammable plan as defined in NFPA 32, which I plan to meet Chapter 4, or Type 4, which is pretty extensive, and a supervised heat or smoke detector system be installed, which I agreed to and which I had planned to put in the building anyway. I already have in the other part of it.
Heat and smoke? Heat
and smoke. And 24-hour monitored.
Any other questions or comments from board members? Mr. Russ?
This is a very complete application for a relatively small project. We appreciate the level of detail which you provided us. My major concern is not the traffic as much as the turning that is going to take place on 77. I agree with Mr. Bray that the traffic that exists on the street isn't going to change much as a result of the business, but the way in which it moves is going to change substantially. This will now be the third business driveway within, say, 380 to 400 foot site distance that's indicated on your plans. It's an awkward intersection to begin with because it's slightly off center.
Right.
Scott Dyer, Shore Road, and 77 come together. That's my major concern, and I don't know what decision, if any, the board is going to be making. I'd like to encourage all of us to take a very careful look at the traffic study and the implications of the turn. And not so much kind of be concerned about the level of traffic or the volume of traffic. It's a very busy road, especially during the late spring, summer, early fall of the year.
Well, Bill, is there anything that you might be able to say or to shed some light on that might allay fears in regard to the turning radiuses?
Yes. One observation that I made from Mr. Bray's report, the accident report that showed 14 accidents between the period of 83 and 85, I actually counted 11 on the plan. Seven of the 11, or close to 70%, were as a result of turning and not rear end collisions. Points up to my concern.
Yeah, Mr. Russ, again, keeping in mind that those accidents occurred at the intersection, not back from the intersection, one thing that Route 77 has that many roadways do not have is sufficient width to allow a vehicle to pull close to the center line and a through vehicle to proceed around that vehicle, whereas a narrower street, you may encounter a great number of rear-end collisions when that extra width was not available. Also, approaching the site from either direction, there is clearly plenty, if you will, if you want to use that term, of sight distance on the street. When you look back to the driveway, there is less sight distance, but the vertical curve and the horizontal curve along Route 77 has been designed by MDOT standards, and there is more than adequate room for vehicle sight lines to hopefully minimize the effect that turning traffic would have on the number of rear-end collisions that may be encountered.
Thank you, Mr. Bray. Any other questions or comments? I think this is a very carefully and meticulously prepared submission. I think that the board would not feel comfortable taking any action tonight until perhaps they've had an opportunity to go and actually visit the site, and I don't think we have to do this as a whole group, and I think it would be important and valuable to our assessment to do that at least individually, and hope that you wouldn't mind if we popped in to view that. I wonder if the board wants to ask for any figures from the police on speed counts. I understand perhaps they do have that, but it might be helpful to us in evaluating if that seems like something that would be good to do. Anything else? If not, we thank you very much for your presentation, and the next submission date is July 29th, so that if you have any other materials that you would like to put before us, then that would be the time to turn them in for August.
Right. I was here at the last meeting, but
I understand, and we seem to be jammed up in in the summertime, like the beaches and everything else, but we will certainly...
Well, the only point I wanted to make was I have a substantial investment already, and the clock is ticking, and even though this is a small project, I did try to take and do everything that you would probably request on a large project, because I wanted it to move forward without finding items that I hadn't addressed. Obviously, you found a couple.
Well, I think it would be wise to invest just a little more time to look at some of these areas of concern, such as the traffic and the sight distance, before we make a final determination.
I think that talking to Chief Pickering, you're going to find that the speeds there are less than what
I know that Mr. Bray.
Speed. Which I don't mind that at all, which will negate the fact of the sight distance is just being... I certainly don't want to take that tree down or have anybody take down.
I appreciate that.
It's a nice tree.
All right. Thank you very much. One further comment, Mr. Butler.
I just wanted to ask Mr. Griffin if he had copies of the plans that he might want to submit right now for the next packet.
I just thought you might have...
I did start mentioning that. Thank you, Mr.
I have Mr. Haskell here with me tonight, and I don't think there was any question, but if there was, he'd certainly not have to answer.
Are there any questions of Mr. Haskell at this time? Thank you for coming. Our next item of business is I. Allen Balfour, a request for a zone change from RP to RA on Pine Ridge Road. And this is dealing with section 19-4-9. And we have a representative here, Mr. Balfour.
Madam Chairman, my name is William Dale. I'm a lawyer from Portland. I'm here tonight on behalf of Mr. Balfour and his proposed zone change request to rezone a portion of the Broad Cove subdivision from Resource Protection to Residence A. We have previously submitted our application along with a cover letter dated February 11, addressed to the town manager, which provided some background to the application. And our plans have been drawn by Sebago Techniques, and they have previously been submitted under latest revision date of June 17. Walter Stinson from Sebago Technics is here with me this evening. Although he and I are both here and would be pleased to answer any questions, it's my understanding that the principal purpose, indeed perhaps the only purpose of tonight's item on the agenda, is for the board to set a public hearing for a later date. So again, we'd be pleased to answer any questions, but I gather you're simply going to set up the public hearing. And with that, I'll defer.
Thank you, Mr. Dale. Are there some questions of the planning board? I think one thing that perhaps would be very helpful for us before we consider a public hearing is to have a detailed explanation as to why you feel it is appropriate to change from an RP to an RA zone.
Yes, and again, I'd be pleased to do that tonight. I'm just a little hesitant because the last time I started to speak on the merits and the matter hadn't been advertised first for public hearing, I think the neighbors, many of whom are opposed to the project, I concede, felt that they hadn't had notice, and so a lot of them weren't down here and couldn't hear my comments. I'm pleased to go forward. I just don't want to get caught.
I assure you that you'll have a chance to repeat your speech, but I think it would be very valuable for the planning board to know before we go into a public hearing mode.
Okay. If I could ask Walter, who has got a poster board with him, to bring that up. To move this lectern,
yes,
for people to see.
Yes, if you could move that a little closer towards, that would help. Thank you. That's good.
Yep. Can everybody see all right?
Yes,
all right?
That's fine.
Let me orient you. The 13 lots shaded in light green on the plan are the 13 lots in question, owned by Mr. Balfour. He is the original developer of the Broad Cove subdivision, which was approximately 130 lots, including these 13, which were reviewed and approved by the planning board back in 1964. As I'm sure you know, they've all been built out and are improved with nice single-family homes today. These are the last 13 lots which he owns and which he now wants to develop also for single-family home house lots. In approximately 1978, the town of Cape Elizabeth rezoned this last section of 13 lots from Residence A to Resource Protection. Under the terms of your zoning ordinance, single-family homes are not allowed in the Resource Protection Zone. Because Mr. Balfour now wants to develop these lots, four house lots, he's here asking for the zone change. We have submitted, as required by the terms of the town zoning ordinance, a set of engineered plans from Sebago Technics showing all of the various requirements of the ordinance in terms of site plan submissions with all of the soils and wetlands and so forth shown on the plan. We've submitted, I think, two revisions, and the most recent one is dated June 17th, and so that's the one that should be controlling. We have shown on here, just for purposes of illustration, a common septic system on lot 101. Obviously, it'd be Mr. Balfour's preference, and we think it'd be better for the area for the 13 lots to feed into the town's public sewer system, but under the terms of the sewer ordinance, that may not be possible. So we at least at this point are showing a common collection system there on lot 101. I won't repeat, Madam Chairman, all of the sort of legal and equitable arguments we made in our February 11th letter. You've seen those before, and I suspect that the public hearing will be asked to address all those again, and I guess we will want to. the principal point or the principal standard that we have to meet under your zoning ordinance and under state law to be entitled to a zone change is that the zone change is consistent with or pursuant to the town's comprehensive plan. And that's why we're here. We believe, given the rest of the development here of the 117 lots for single-family homes, and given the configuration of this resource protection zone, and it's shown down here in the lower right-hand corner in the location map, the rest of the resource protection zone and how it catches just the end of these 13 lots and indeed loops up here. I'll try and stand aside so everyone can see. It loops up here to catch one, two, three other existing single-family homes. We think the way that zone line runs unfairly impacts on these remaining 13 lots to deprive them of any use. We don't think it would be inconsistent with the comprehensive plan. Indeed, only this area, I believe it is just this area here that's shaded in the darker shading, and over here is Sebago Mucky Peat, which of course is one of the standards under the town's zoning ordinances for characterizing or locating a resource protection zone. Obviously, none of this existing roadway, this portion of the roadway in any event, is currently Sebago Mucky Peat. None of this down here is. The other soil types are shown on the plans that you have in front of you. But basically, we think that this would be consistent with the comprehensive plan to put, to allow single-family homes in there. And we think the way the zone lines fall on the tail end of this 130-unit project, the rest of which have been built out, including some that are in this zone, that's unfair to the developer. So, again, I'd be pleased to try to answer any questions, and Mr. Stinson is here as well, and I suspect we'll want to go through this again next month.
Have you a copy of our zone change checklist? You do have a copy of that. There are a couple of things there that I think we need in written form, and one would be a statement which describes the consistency with the comprehensive plan and the zoning ordinance, and another is another statement indicating the zone change's compatibility with the surrounding neighborhood, and most importantly, the impact on the value of adjacent properties. This is under 19-4-9A5, and those are pretty important to have in our packets